if psychology and pop culture had a baby, they'd call it Shrink Tank.
There is a sort of pendulum that's swinging back and forth where we kind of go from one extreme.
And I think there's an element of truth to
because
this.
I have something interesting later in the show that will make you feel very weird.
From Nashville and Charlotte, this is the Shrink Tank Podcast. Welcome back, everybody. Thanks for joining us again. I'm Dave Verhagen in Nashville. We have a great show for you. We're picking up in our conversation of the psychology of Michael Jackson and Leaving Neverland. This is the second part of our conversation. First, we're going to meet our Charlotte panel. Dr. Emma Kate Wright is here. Emma Kate, let me ask you, as we're picking up this conversation from the last discussion, last time we talked about the psychology of Michael Jackson. Today, we're going to talk more about the accusers, the victims, the psychology of trauma, and the documentary itself. What was your emotional reaction to watching this documentary?
So I actually was by myself watching this, which was a horrible decision. Do not watch this alone. And I started texting our producer, Sean, because my mind was just being completely overwhelmed with all of the awful graphic descriptions that were being said. And I was like, I need to talk to somebody about this. So it was a lot.
Yeah, it was intense. Normally, Dr. Frank Gaskell's with us, but he's not here today. He had a bigger name on the other line. And we're also talking about a serious subject, so I don't know that he could handle it. So we'll give him a pass for today. But Jonathan Hederle is here. And Jonathan, you were a lifelong Michael Jackson fan, as we established in the last podcast. What was your emotional reaction to watching this documentary?
Well, if I'm being honest, when I became a teenager and Michael really started in the 90s with his Dangerous album and later on, I really kind of moved away from Michael Jackson because there was just enough kind of weird and unsettling things about him that I really was just my pop culture tastes and interests were shifting away from kind of radio pop. So this really wasn't so much a shock to me in terms of what was being shared. When I was watching it, having just worked with young guys and a number that have been victims of trauma or sexual abuse, as I'm watching it and I'm hearing their stories, my first response is, yeah, that makes sense. I have seen that in my clinical experience. And I think that's one of the advantages for me, and maybe a disadvantage of the casual viewer, is understanding oftentimes how trauma works in the brain and in people's lives, that a lot of what they're sharing doesn't seem suspicious to me. It seems very understandable and normal. You know, recognizing that this is a one-sided documentary, don't want to take away from that, but at no point did I, as I'm watching it, I'm like, this is not true. This is so fabricated. They're making it up. I'm connecting all these things that I've heard before from other people.
So that's my next question that I want to ask. We have implied this. I don't know that we've said it outright, but when you watch this documentary, you're sitting with these folks for 4 hours total. You're sitting with Wade Robson, you're sitting with James Safechuck and their families, and you're listening. And at the end of the day, you're probably going to land on the side of I believe them or I don't believe them, or I am not sure. And Emma Kate, where did you land on this?
So I remember thinking for sure I 100% believed Jimmy after part one. I wasn't sure about Wade until part two. And I think it was, it shows you how everybody responds differently to trauma. And Jimmy, for those who watch it, you can just clearly see it's so visible how upsetting the whole experience was, having to talk through it, relive it. Even the editing within the film, you can hear when they're discussing things like a swallow, like that just uncomfortable anxiety, the level of physiological arousal that they're probably experiencing. And people always have this perception that you're going to be boohooing, bawling your eyes out over something, which you may at times. But these are also men talking about their trauma. And I think a lot of people were referencing the R. Kelly documentary about surviving R. Kelly where it was women and they were crying. And so I think it's just really critical for everybody to understand that every person's journey with trauma has its own nuances.
Jonathan.
I think anybody that's already willing to watch the documentary is curious enough. It's going to be really hard not to walk away from this viewing experience at the bare minimum to say, Michael Jackson made a lot of questionable kind of either choices or decisions, because I mean it's on record he would let little boys sleep in his bed with him. Like, there's at the bare minimum he lived a very problematic and questionable life when it came to his interactions with young children and boys. And I think most likely people are going to walk away believing at the bare minimum that he probably sexually abused children, if not, even if they don't believe Wade or Jimmy, which I think it's really hard to not walk away, say something really traumatic and devastating happened to not just these boys, but their family.
Oh, yeah.
But then when you hear more about the other criminal investigations and trials, like where there's a pattern that starts to emerge, you have to really step back and say, where there's smoke, is there fire?
So to pin you down a little bit, and you can say, I don't know, but in your answer, you're saying it would be hard to watch this without coming to that conclusion. But when you watched it personally, mm-hmm. where did you land?
Well, I went into the documentary, even as a childhood super fan of Michael Jackson, I was already of the mindset for probably the last 15, 20 years that he likely sexually abused and had inappropriate interactions with boys. Well, after watching this, I believe Wade and Jimmy. Like, and it's really a challenge because on the one hand, I have two values that I really try to uphold, and they're clashing. On the one, it's that I believe in our legal system of innocent until proven guilty. I believe that's one of the things that makes America great. But I also recognize the small percentage of the victims that actually ever go public and endure the public scrutiny and the doubt and the ongoing re-experiencing of their trauma. And so I tend to also fall into believing victims when they have the courage and tenacity to come forward. And that's really the clash that I had with this documentary, is I tend to believe victims, and I also believe in our legal system. And this may be one of those really unsettling examples of where our justice system, and then the fact that Michael Jackson is no longer alive, kind of really failed.
So did you believe these two guys?
I do.
So, yeah, there's an issue with it being kind of a standard of justice of, you know, innocent until proven guilty from a legal standpoint. But there's also some aspects of this that can never be resolved legally. I mean, just given the fact that he's passed on, the time frame, all kinds of things are not going to allow this to be resolved from a legal standpoint, more than likely. And there are also different standards of criminal behavior and a civil case. Those are different legal mm-hmm. standards as well. But it sounds like all three of us, and I'll go on record and say I absolutely believed both of them. I 100% believe both of them. It sounds like that's where we're landing, that we watch this, we walk away from it saying, we believe these two men are telling the truth. When you watch this, and then for those of you who saw the follow-up with Oprah, where do you think they are from what you are observing in their own journey of dealing with this? Is there a difference between where Wade is and where Jimmy is? And how would you describe that?
I think if people watch the Oprah follow-up, it's not – you don't have to be a psychologist to figure that one out. Jimmy clearly is less developed in terms of his processing of what happened to him. But I also get the sense that he was wooed in a different way because he and Michael exchanged vows and a ring. And he, you could just tell he loved him, truly loved him. And to finally come to terms with that and all the things that happened and what does that mean about who you are and what your life was like as a child and everything being a lie, that is some real, I mean, there aren't enough words to describe how heavy that is.
Yeah, and I don't want to compare the two, I can't say we're all, this is all speculative, but there's some things that I naturally observed watching the documentary and the Oprah interviews that are also on HBO. One was that Wade has a lot more family support system with his sister and his brother, and you see how this has devastated their family, but you see that he is not alone in his anger and guilt and processing this to where, you know, Jimmy's an only child. Wade, in a lot of ways, has lived a very professionally successful life, so he has, I think, other outlets where he finds meaning and purpose, or even just on a really, really horrific day, distraction, something to absorb himself in. We see really early on Jimmy just struggling professionally or personally, just kind of wanting to shut down and be a shut-in for days or weeks on end. We hear about it from his wife. And I think the biggest thing for me is the fact that Wade showed a greater degree of awareness and processing to where when he did the interview in Good Morning America in 2013, when he filed the lawsuit, that is really what Jimmy needed to start to organize and make sense of what was going on with him. So if you think about that, in a lot of ways, Jimmy is saying it's really only been the last 5 or 6 years that he has started to come to terms and grapple and grasp what happened to him as a child.
So this is a tricky question, and it will probably require some complexity in the answer. But both of these boys reported feeling great love for him, for Michael Jackson. They reported that the experience of the sexual, we'll call it abuse, but the sexual experience was pleasurable. It was emotionally even positive in some ways. And so their early experience of it was not that this was a abuse in the sense of that we often associate with abuse, like being harmed or scared or injured or something like that. Can abuse like that, and this is often the experience that kids who are abused by pedophiles, by those who molest children, that's often their experience, is that it feels like it's part of a relationship. We have a special relationship there. It's the way we show our love for each other, that kind of thing. Can that kind of abuse have a devastating impact on someone if they didn't experience it as abusive in the way that someone else might experience an abusive experience? Do you follow what I'm trying to say? If their experience of it at the time was not abusive, can it later become something that is devastating for them, hard for them? And if so, how does that happen?
Yeah, and we see this in all aspects of life, whether it be religiosity or family dysfunction. When you're young and you don't have a lot of other models or data points to kind of compare and contrast, we develop to have caregivers and to put our blind trust that they are looking out for our best interests. And whether that be priests or religious leaders, whether it be your parents or whether it be someone like Michael Jackson, who both kids had their families, especially their mothers, champion him as, like, you hear both mothers talk about Michael was like a son to me. He was like family. And you see this oftentimes where abuse comes from a family member or somebody that's really close to a family, that only later on, when you start to get other data points, as well as you start to struggle with your emotions and kind of what's going on internally, that some things start to become clear that it's impossible for a seven-year-old to fathom.
So I think one way that might kind of break this down in a little bit easier way for people to understand is when we bring it back to the brain. So our left hemisphere is responsible for language. Our right hemisphere, one of its functions is emotions. So when you are young, you don't truly have the language to describe what's happening to you during abuse. You don't, there's no concept of it. You don't understand sexuality and, you know, what love should feel like, those sorts of things. But yet you have all of these feelings. You've got pleasure, probably confusion, maybe fear, especially if the abuser is saying things like, if anyone finds out about us, this, your life is over, my life is over. And so what happens is slowly, like Jonathan said, data points come along. Maybe they get older. They start to get language to describe things. Maybe they have other experiences. And it's kind of like, how do we connect the two hemispheres, right? So how do we start putting the words with the feelings and processing it? And I think Wade, during the Oprah special, talked about this so beautifully, where he said, you know, by actually going through and sharing his story over the course of several days, long interviews, processing it, seeing the support, talking about it, it was almost like you could just see the two parts of his brain, those two hemispheres were integrating.
So part of what you're hitting on too is that the meaning of it makes a difference. And so when you're a kid, if you have a certain way of thinking about it that you've been led to believe, the meaning of it makes a difference about how it affects you. Later, when you see it through a different lens and the meaning of it becomes different, it hits you like a ton of bricks. And the same thing is true with the healing part of it. And you can see this with Wade as he begins to make meaning of having gone through this and the support that he's received and the way that he's thinking about this. You can see him making different meaning of it as well, that's helping him recover. So that's a big piece of it, is that language, once your brain catches up and has not just the language for it, but also a way of thinking about it, then it can both hit you very hard and also that can aid in the recovery of it, at least for part of that. So here's another piece of this. I just this past week saw a client for the first time who has in the past year had three very big traumatic experiences, traumatic losses. I won't describe them, but there were three things in the course of a 12-month period that were in and of themselves, each of them were big deals. He had three. And he coped pretty well during the year. And then about 3 months, 4 months after the last one was cleared or had happened, all of a sudden he starts having panic attacks. He starts having trouble sleeping. He can't eat. And if you look at during the time when all the stuff was going on, he was actually functioning okay. Then you look 3-4 months later and he's a mess. So how do you make sense of that kind of thing? It's the same basic idea as what we're seeing with these two guys now. How do we think about delayed trauma?
I almost feel like things happen in waves where it's like, okay, you process one aspect of it, and then, because anytime you process a memory, it changes that memory a little bit. And then, okay, so you're trying to wrap your head around, okay, well, what does that mean? And then related to that, there's another aspect that might develop and come up. And then, okay, now I got to figure this piece out. And so it's just this slow, gradual progression through what all of these complex layers mean. You know, how does this shape? I mean, when you think about your identity and your safety and what love is, I mean, there's just so much to unpack and realize how trauma will always be with people forever, but it's how you figure out how to move forward. Hopefully that makes sense.
You know, they both talked about substance abuse or, you know, self-medicating. And that really made me think to how we are wired to have defense mechanisms, whether they're healthy or unhealthy, things that try to protect us. And oftentimes it's to protect us from reality. I mean, the reality was they had horrific things happen to them at an age before they could fully comprehend what was going on or have a voice or agency or the ability to advocate for themselves. So part of defense mechanisms to compartmentalize or to try to make sense of it to where it's like, well, this is love, or the belief that they're being good brothers and good sons by not sharing because of the threat that bad things would happen to others or themselves. I'm not surprised from both of their stories that as they got into close relationships, that started to shatter their defense mechanisms because other people are really loving and caring, but kind of keeping tabs on their level of functioning, as well as that vulnerability. Like when you open any type of deep emotion, it may unintentionally unlock a lot of suppressed negative emotions. And for Jimmy and Wade, that's what we see, whether it be getting married, whether it be having kids, is it just unlocks something that they had either buried or internalized or stuffed for many, many years.
Well, one comment that kind of relates to this and also an earlier point, I found it so unique that both of them, when they had their own kids, it was this new concept that kind of formed in their mind of what does it mean to be a parent? And they could see their child and know what they were going through at their age. And to me, that seemed like this huge catalyst or this breaking point. And I think they both even addressed it in the Oprah special, because they could say, wow, this is what I know I needed in that moment, but I wasn't getting.
Yeah. And if something like this happened to my son, I'd be filled with rage. So why is it okay? Why do I think of it as love?
You know, Jonathan, you mentioned this about substance abuse, drinking, drug use, and other things. And it brings the point up that the issue is not whether someone is going to cope with a traumatic event. It's how they're going to cope, because all those are ways of coping. You know, if someone stays in bed all day, if someone cuts themselves, if someone drinks every day, they're coping. They're just not coping in healthy ways. And so that's the difference that we're seeing, is that moving from poor coping to healthier coping is sort of the progression of handling trauma. The other piece too that hits me about delayed trauma is this. If you listen to them talk, even as they were older, their mindset was, number one, if this gets out, then someone that I love is going, his life is ruined and my life is ruined. And number two, I have to, my job is to protect this man. Right. That was their kind of, that's what I've been charged with. And so when you're in that mode, you're in this hypervigilant state, you're still kind of locked up in that mindset. You don't have a chance to process the trauma. And so that's what I think has happened. Like the guy that I was referring to, that not in the documentary, but the guy who said that had three things during the time that those things were happening, he was having to deal with those things. And he had no bandwidth to process that stuff, to deal with it. And then later, once it's clear, then it all hits him. Same thing for these guys. They're in survival mode. It's like, if this gets out, our lives are ruined. If this gets out, the person that we love is ruined. So they didn't have any room in their head to process it. So it makes sense that it's years later, especially as they become parents. So let's talk about that with, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, and that's really one of the misbeliefs around traumas. People just focus on the physical act or the sex act, and they don't acknowledge all of the lead up of the grooming or the you're safe with me, I have your best interests at heart, you're special, and then gradual touch is introduced, and then it starts shifting towards secrets. This is our little secret, or fear and intimidation, and placing the responsibility and the onus and the guilt and shame on the victim. And then long after, you have intrusive memories. You have the inability to sleep, inability to cope, and sometimes you don't understand it. Like these both of these guys and victims of abuse, they're victimized a lot longer than the actual physical act that occurred.
Right. And I think you're bringing up a really good point, too, in terms of just the common stereotype that's portrayed about abuse within films and television is it's normally this really aggressive, violent, graphic thing when in the moment, and we've alluded to this earlier, you know, it's unfortunately it feels good. I mean, it's a sexual act and it doesn't come across that way. They're not wrapping their head around what it actually is. And I think Oprah said it best, if they're a good abuser, you're not going to know it until later.
And that's what happened. So let's shift to talking about the role of the parents, particularly the moms in this whole scenario. And the theme of the mom and the mom's relationship with Michael Jackson, the accused, the mom's relationship with the kid, and whether they failed to protect, whether they were groomed themselves. What's your take on the role, particularly of the mom, in both cases, for Jimmy and for Wade, in these stories?
So they both were absolutely groomed. Now, there's a lot of layers here, but I think we've discussed this point where society as a whole was somewhat groomed because of the perception that was out there about Michael Jackson. So they came into their relationships with Michael through that lens thinking, oh, you know, he's this man who does all these great things with kids. And so there wasn't as much of a seed of concern or doubt. And then he also was using his power and his money and the luxury and the illusion or potential opportunity for careers to really pull these parents in. And so it was almost just, I mean, because they were blind to the abuse because of who he was. And it's hard to try to look for those bad things or the red flags when there's also so many other great things happening. And he was buying them homes, and Jimmy got a car when he turned 16. You know, and they just also saw this side of him too, where he was sad and lonely. And he made them feel like they were so important, because here's Michael Jackson asking them to go pick him up from the airport when this man has millions and millions of dollars and can obviously do that, and wanting to stay at our home and eat dinner with us when he could be anywhere else in the world. And it was, so he made the parents feel like they were saving him. And so it's just really interesting. And you also get a very clear picture of the guilt, because there really is not, there's no way to go back on any of this. And your one role as a parent, or one of your roles, is to keep your kids safe. And these women clearly know and feel that they failed tremendously.
Obviously, the person that I have the most anger and contempt towards is Michael Jackson. Maybe his lawyers, too. But when I was watching this documentary, I just found myself getting increasingly angry at Wade's mom in particular. And it really made me step back and sort of ask, you know, why? Because, I mean, there was just a... It's hard because there is this weird dilemma, because on the one hand, both moms made, I think, some questionable decisions. Even after the first lawsuit that was settled out, like, they still allowed their sons to spend time in Michael Jackson's room after he's been accused of child sexual abuse. But they were groomed, and everybody co-signs that at many, many points, both mothers asked their sons, you know, has anything happened to you? And both of them repeatedly said no. And so that's a hard place to be. I mean, I think Jimmy's mom, I think I got the sense that she has willingly taken on a lot more responsibility and blame. She blames herself. She beats herself up. It was harder to get a sense of Wade's mom. I think it's kind of telling to me, at least as a viewer, that all of the children have a really fractured relationship with their mom. And I think Wade's family life is it's so traumatic and devastating in its own right, because the dad gets diagnosed with bipolar. They basically abandon him to go to America because of Michael Jackson. The older brother has some type of connection with him, but even he wants to go spend time with his mom, with his sister, with his brother. And when he leaves the next day, what does the dad do? He hangs himself. Like, just a very, just a Michael Jackson just destroyed every one of those family members. And so, but I have to admit, I was getting really mad at Wade's mom.
It was, I mean, I agree. It was really frustrating, because just without a doubt, who in their right mind would be like, oh, yes, my small 7-year-old child can sleep with this adult stranger in their bed? Just.
And I think I know the point where I really got mad with her, which was the second legal case. And Wade said, I do not want to defend. I do not want to go to trial. And she tried to talk him in, or pressure or guilt him to doing that. And to me, that's like, that's a huge red flag, number one. But number two is like, if somebody doesn't want to go through that, like, that to me was a huge, like, misstep, however you want to, you know, frame that.
Well, you know, I'm the parent of four kids. Jonathan, you have two daughters. And I would like to think, my kids are all grown now, they're in their 20s, but I would like to think that I would not be dumb enough to let my kid spend the night in an adult's bed, even a family member or a close family friend. But that being said, I kind of found myself thinking that they had made bad decisions, particularly Wade's mom. But also I felt, I really am not on the pile on the mom bandwagon here, because I don't think we know what it would be like to be faced with the scenario they were faced with. Here's the biggest superstar in the world who's showing interest in not only your kid, but in you, and has convinced you that he is a childlike, benign, kind person that wants only good things for your kid. And I think they were really convinced of that. And so then years go on and you're in that context and you don't have evidence. Like, we're looking at it through the lens backwards. We're looking through the perspective of that we have now, but from their perspective at the time, they didn't have a lot of reason to think something bad's going on. I don't think, at least that wasn't portrayed in the documentary. And so I don't know what it would be like to be. I think it would be very easy for someone to be drawn into that web and to be suckered as they were. So I think they made mistakes. I would like to think I wouldn't have made those mistakes as a parent, but I also don't know anywhere close to what that would be like. I have no idea.
Yeah. And I think, honestly, Dave, you're bringing up a really valid point that kind of brings it all back to this power and affluence piece, because these families, they didn't come, you know, they weren't necessarily impoverished by any means. They were just middle class. And, you know, to then be thrust into this world of luxury and have all these things given to you under the illusion that, oh, this person just genuinely wants to be kind and helpful, you know, who wouldn't be appreciative of that and who wouldn't be okay with that?
Yeah, and I mean, I agree with you, Dave. I'm not really a big throw parents under the bus. In fact, when I was getting really mad, I kind of had to step back and say, like, why am I getting really mad? Because, I mean, there is so much in the documentary that highlights the grooming, the power, the seduction of the entire family. But I think especially with Wade's siblings, there is a lot of anger that they have, and I could feel it, you know, come out of the documentary. And I certainly don't bemoan or challenge Jimmy, Wade, or their family's anger, because I think it's part of their healing process, is for them to start to feel what they feel and to not have anybody sort of like dismiss it or moralize it that you shouldn't, because otherwise they're going to continue to be such fractured young men that don't have the emotional landscape to understand what's going on within them.
Yeah, and I think, I can't remember where I heard somebody describe this. It might have been in the documentary, but somebody used the word the phrase willful blindness. And I really, that really resonated with me, because they absolutely were blind to it. And you have to ask yourself, okay, they're portraying a certain perception in this documentary. There probably were red flags, and they probably did have that moment where they're like, wait a minute, what is going on here? But that level of the ability of the abuser to plant those seeds of doubt, I think, is the factor. And so for them to choose to turn the other cheek, I think, is hard.
And, you know, Frank, who's not here, he was talking about Macaulay Culkin and, you know, whether or not Michael had an inappropriate relationship with Macaulay or other people. And my thinking is like, if someone is a serial abuser of children, it's only possible if you find a family that you can groom, that can be sort of seduced in a number of ways to that power and allure. And so I would not be shocked if Michael Jackson had a number of friendships and relationships with kids that he didn't sexually abuse, simply because there was not really the opportunity to seduce and groom the family and the parents, which you need in order to have that access.
At least you need it in order to have repeated access and for it to be an extended period of abuse, for sure. Two more questions. The first is, one of the criticisms of the documentary is that it only presents one side. It is not a balanced piece, in the sense of, we're going to ask people who represent Michael Jackson, his family, his attorneys, or so on, to speak. We're just going to show the stories of these two men. We said earlier in the podcast we believe them, but do you have any questions or reservations about the frame of the documentary, about the limitations of the documentary?
So I feel mixed on this, because there are aspects where, yeah, it would be really nice to get both sides of the story. But at the same time, though, culturally, what always seems to be the focus is, here are these people coming out. All they want is attention or money or fame. And it was really nice to hear this very chronological, detailed, graphic progression of their stories, just letting them have the opportunity without the constant back and forth of, here's evidence for, here's evidence against. It was just their story. And I think that is something that, again, is a shift in our culture, where now we are more willing to listen. And okay, we may have our doubts, but we are at least giving individuals the opportunity to feel more comfortable to say their truth. And that is huge to me about this documentary.
I don't think you can present a documentary that exposes a very revered and loved celebrity or famous person where there's not going to be some major blowback and criticism. And if that's the reality, which I generally believe, like, even if Michael Jackson's estate had opportunity to be a part of this, like, no matter what, you know, Wade and Jimmy and their families, they're on the defensive. And that's just the unfortunate nature of victims. And so I appreciate that this is really a documentary about them. even though we spent half of these two episodes talking about Michael Jackson. It's essentially Dan Reed said, I want to give you guys a platform and a chance to tell your story so it's not a headline, it's not a lawsuit that's been dismissed, that you get to talk about what really happened and give your family a platform to talk about how they were all duped or seduced or groomed and how they've all had to grapple with this and how it's, in a lot of ways, greatly damaged or ruined lives. So I'm fine with it being one-sided because I just don't know what would have been accomplished if they had Michael Jackson's estate be a part of it. And Michael can't speak for himself at this point either. So that's the limitation as well.
So, and I guess I'm going to kind of add to an aspect of what you just said, Jonathan, where the media, when you think about it, so you've got this celebrity, and this could be true for any sort of scandal. The media is going to immediately go to the celebrity because they already have access to them. And they have a lot more resources and a lot more pull and a lot more power to help shape and shift the story or to do some digging to find damaging information about somebody. And it's almost like this documentary was a beautiful platform in the sense that, okay, normal avenues of assistance in these sort of situations are tough to come by for a lot of families where you may not have the economic means to go through the hours and months or even years worth of litigation that would come with a lawsuit to try to put some person in their place from this legal perspective, when even then, you know, no amount of money is really going to fix this issue or take away that pain.
And that's where I land, is that when we talk about when the criticism is that this is unbalanced, I would say that the whole cultural conversation has been unbalanced, where you've got a celebrity who's revered, who has a fan base of millions of supporters. You've got millions of dollars and you can afford high powered legal defense and PR, and you can curate your image and put everything out there that you want to and attack people. I think just to have, to add to the balance of the picture, to have it unadulterated, unfiltered, just here is the story of these guys, and then you can hear them, listen to them, decide for yourself. I think that, to me, is what the strength and the power of this documentary was. It was this, they're not saying we're showing all sides of this. They're saying we're showing the story, these guys' stories and their perspectives. Now you decide if, do you find them credible? Do you believe them? So I think in that sense, I think it was very powerful. Last question here, getting back to the issue of trauma, any thoughts just in general about how we think about recovery from trauma and how the process and journey of healing, what that looks like? Emma Kate, any thoughts about that?
Oh, yeah. So I think one thing that is a really big misconception with trauma is this idea of closure. And I know that's really hard, and maybe people aren't going to like that I'm saying that, but in my opinion, I don't think closure really exists to an extent, but what does exist is a nonlinear path to healing. And when I say nonlinear, I think we've already discussed this, where there are times where you seem to be doing better, and then there are times where you're not doing better. And you can, maybe people can relate to this even with the loss of a loved one. When somebody really special close to you dies, it's a really horrible event. You pick up the pieces, you start living your life again, and then maybe something reminds you of that person, and then you lose it again. And so what people have to come to the conclusion is we always have to give space without letting people get stuck. Because I think what happens is people get stuck in this victimhood, and we have to allow them to find a way to rewrite their stories so they can find a sense of meaning from it, maybe for a greater good or just for the good of themselves or their families. But we can't expect just the book to close and the chapter be done.
Yeah, I think one of the things that I work with in therapy with young guys that have been victims of some form of trauma or abuse is it's really about helping them take back control of their lives. And fundamentally, it starts with you get to decide how much this trauma defined you. You get to say whether or not you find power in it really being a part of your identity and really destigmatize it and break down the power, or you get the power to decide if this is something that happened to you, but it doesn't define me and that it doesn't have to be the main platform of my life and what I talk about and the lens that everything is interpreted or filtered toward. It really is about giving them back agency in their own life because it was robbed from them, you know, with a gross abuse of power and trust of things of that nature. And then the other is just building resiliency, you know, or we know another aspect is post-traumatic growth. It's like you can't undo what's happened to you, but you can find and discover what a meaningful, purposeful, satisfying life is. And I think that kind of builds off what you're talking about, Emma Kate, of like not just wallowing in the pain and the darkness, but start to build a path towards a life that gives you a sense of direction and purpose.
And I'll add too, and I'm sorry, Dave, I genuinely feel like this is an important time right now because we've had so much movement towards allowing people to speak their truth and to share their stories. However, I have to emphasize and underline that we can't get stuck and we can't choose to just let that be our whole story. So, yes, you want to look towards the past and reflect on it and make meaning, but you also need to be grounded in the present moment and look forward and try to figure out what do you want in your life, what's going to give you meaning, because that's what's going to help change your sense of self. It's going to change your relationships with people. It's going to change your life philosophies and push you down a positive road to healing.
Good words and good discussion. And that's going to do it for this edition of the Shrink Tank podcast. We hope you'll check out shrinktank.com for great articles and videos, and also the first part of this podcast if you haven't heard it. You can follow us on Twitter at shrink_tank and like us on Facebook. And for questions or comments, please drop us a note. Our email is feedback@shrinktank.com. If you like the show, we hope you'll give us a great review on iTunes. It really helps us build our audience, and we greatly appreciate it. Our producer and theme music composer is Sean Beck. Our associate producer and social media guru is Mariel Butler. For Emma Kate Wright and Jonathan Hederle in Charlotte, I'm Dave Verhagen in Nashville. Tell all your friends about us and make it a great week.